Hello and welcome to another edition of Surviving Scientology Radio with your host, Jeffrey Augustine. Today we have on with us a special guest, the author of Ruthless, Scientology, my son David Miscavige, and me, Ron Miscavige Sr. Ron, welcome to the show.
Thanks, Jeffrey. I'm glad to be on.
I had heard rumors that you had left the church sometime around 2012. When do you escape from Scientology and what happens? How does the book come about?
All right, so let me start from the get-go here. I escaped from the international base on March 25th, 2012. I came to Wisconsin, and I was living there, and about a year and a half later, a private investigator was caught by a neighbor who spotted him outside acting suspicious around the corner from my house. He had been looking to buy the house so he could spy on me from that vantage point. Now, these were two guys. It was a guy and his son. They were a team. They were being paid $10,000 a week by the Church of Scientology to report on my every movement between 8 o'clock in the morning and 8 o'clock at night. At any rate, when the police came and questioned him what he was doing, he started giving them a little bit of lip. And they said, well, okay, you're under arrest. So they went to check his van. And in the van, they found 5 license plates from 5 different states, a stun gun, 5 pistols, 2 rifles, 1 fitted up with a homemade silencer, and over 1,000 rounds of ammunition. And that's how this kicks off, and my book takes you before then, right to the beginning, and all the subsequent events that took place after that. So I guess that's a good starting point for us to talk, Jeffrey.
It's stunning to think about the Church of Scientology spending $10,000 a week of tax-exempt money, because they do have IRS religious tax exemption. Should a religion hire armed private investigators to stalk a former member? Ron, how did the police tell you about these armed PIs who were following you?
The arresting officer was a guy by the name of Nick Pye, who's now been promoted to lieutenant, and he's in charge of a shift of the West Dallas Police Force here in Milwaukee. Well, I live in West Dallas, but you might as well say Milwaukee. It's the bigger metropolitan area. What happened is I was living with my mother-in-law down in Whitewater, and one evening I had a knock on the door, and I opened up the door, and there was a police officer there, and I said, what's up? He says, are you Ron Miscavige? I said, yeah. He says, well, I'd like to talk to you. So I didn't want to alarm my mother-in-law, because she's not too tough, let's put it that way. So I said, look, let's go outside the garage. I'll meet you over there. So I went through the garage, meet him outside, and I says, what's up? Because I was concerned. Why would a cop be coming to my door in Whitewater? He said, look, I got to tell you something. You've been followed by private investigators hired by the Church of Scientology for the past year and a half. And I says, man, you've got to be kidding me. Is this a joke? He says, no, it's not a joke. And he says, if you want more information, you can contact the West Dallas Police, and they'll fill you in on all the things that happened. So he gave me their phone number, and the next day I was going to call them. Well, I did call them, but they said, listen, we're sending down somebody to check your car out for a GPS. And they sent down a police officer and a guy from the Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms Department of the government. And he was going to check in various wheel wells, and for some reason he got sick. He couldn't complete it. So I called the cops and I said, hey, listen, this isn't happening here. And they said, well, come down tomorrow morning. So I went to the West Dallas Police. And immediately I drove my car into the bay where they check out the police cars, and they put it up on the lift. And the guy looked up on the right rear wheel well, and he says, yep, here's where it was, and you can see the scratches. They took it off. And you could see exactly where the magnet, it's so powerful, in taking it off, it scratches the metal. And that's where the GPS was. And then Nick Pye said, this is people being hired by the Church of Scientology, and they've been following you for a year and a half. Do you have any idea why they were following you? And I said, well, look, I don't know. I mean, you know, I'm the father of the chairman of the board. Maybe they thought I was going to go to the press or something, or a little worried about that. Or maybe my son was concerned with my health. And Nick Pye said, listen, man, I don't know how to tell you this, but I'm going to have to. And there was this moment where I'm thinking, now, what the hell is he going to tell me now? So he said, look, these guys were following you around. You went shopping at a store in Janesville. It was an Aldi supermarket. And you reached over and clutched your left chest with your hand. They thought you were having a heart attack. So they called into their contact and said, look, it looks like the target is having a heart attack. By the way, they used to refer to me as a target. And now imagine this. They have 5 handguns and 2 rifles, one with a silencer in the truck, and over 1,000 rounds of ammunition. Anyway, they called in and they said, it looks like the target is having a heart attack. And whoever answered it was a guy named Greg, that's what they said, hang on a second. So a couple minutes went by, and a person came on and identified himself as David Miscavige. And he said, listen, if it's his time to die, let him die. Don't intervene. Don't do anything. Well, this stunned these guys. I mean, these are PIs, but they hung up. The father said to the son, listen, he says, I don't care what he says. If that old man is having a heart attack, you call 911. Don't go near him, because if they take pictures of us, you know, we could be fined because we're not supposed to get involved in this. But you call 911 on them. Now, Jeffrey, what actually happened was this is the summertime, and I had a pocket T-shirt on. I went and I was shopping for groceries at a place called Aldi's. I come out, and I was putting the groceries in the car, and I bent forward, and my cell phone was in my T-shirt pocket. I reached over with my hand to grab it because I thought it was going to fall on the ground when I bent over. And that's what happened. And, of course, they thought it was a heart attack. And then Nick Pye, who told me this story, had me come over, and I listened to the entire interview that they did with the guys, and I heard this. I heard what the father said. I heard what the son said. And I'll be honest with you, it was shocking to me. Now, I got to tell you this. Even with that, I wasn't going to do anything. All I wanted to do was get in touch with Dave and say, listen, knock this shit off of people following me. I don't like it. So I called RTC. I called different numbers. I couldn't get through it all. So finally, an attorney called me, and he said, now get this. He said to me, Dave won't call you because he doesn't feel he can trust you.
Ron, they're following you for 2 years with armed private investigators, and you're the one who can't be trusted?
Yeah, I just wanted to make that point.
Yeah.
So finally, we're talking. I says, hey, listen, don't follow me. Knock this shit off. He says, is that a threat? I says, well, I don't care. You want to take it any way you want to. I just don't like it. So it ended off in a stalemate. We talked back and forth for a while, and, you know, I accused him of being Perry Mason. He's trying to pull some crap on me where they have every right to follow me. It's a very honorable thing to be a private investigator. It's so honorable that you have to have a license. So that makes it okay in their mind. Okay, I didn't do anything. Now, meanwhile, my daughters had disconnected from me. When I got out, I was in very much calm with both Denise and Lori for months. And then it came a point where Lori said, Dad, look, I spoke to RTC, and they said the only reason somebody blows is because of overage, which that's the party line to give people. It doesn't matter that you're living a miserable fucking life and you can't call anybody without having somebody listen in, or you have your mail checked before it goes out or before you get it, or you can't leave the base. Those are wonderful living conditions, you know. But anyway, after a while, I thought, you know what, I'm going to go and see my daughters to see if I can get back in communication with them. So Becky and I got in the car, drove to Clearwater, went to my daughter Lori's place. There was no answer. There was no car out front. Went to Denise's place, and her husband Jerry came to the front door with a dog barking in the back room, and he had the door open about 3 inches. And I said, Jerry, I'd like to talk to Denise. And the reason I wanted to talk to her, I had CDs of this interview, what the cop said about David calling them and saying, if it's his time to die, let him die. I wanted them to hear this, to tell them to listen. This situation they're involved in isn't okay. So anyway, I'm going back and forth with Jerry, and he says, well, you got to go to the church to get this handled. I said, Jerry, you're out of your mind. That's not going to do anything. The only way I can resolve this is get back in communication with Denise and Lori. Went back and forth for about 20 minutes. Finally, I said, well, look, what does this mean? He said, well, I'll tell you what. Denise and I are through with you and Becky forever. At that point, I thought, okay, I'm writing a book. I'm going to expose you. I'm going to expose this policy of disconnection. because I think it's the most toxic thing you can do to a person. I raised these kids. I'm the one that got them in Scientology, and now my two daughters, all of their children, and their great-grandchildren will not talk to me. And you know how this goes, Jeffrey. Whether they agree with this or not will never be known unless I were to talk to them in person, apart from anybody connected with the church. Because if they were to talk to me, their friends would disconnect from them. Lori, who has a job or had a job with the Scientology company, would lose her job that day. And it's leverage all the way. So that was the point that I decided to write this book. And I decided that I would, look, if I did a blog, what am I going to get? A couple thousand people reading it?
Right.
No, I knew this, that if I wrote a book simply because of the connections and me being David's father, I would get some national attention. And it did happen. And I had millions of people see me being interviewed. And if I can deliver a body blow that that toxic policy they have of breaking up families and ruining people's lives, well, that is the reason I wrote the book, Jeffrey. Sorry to go on so long, but that's the real long story in a nutshell.
Ron, I applaud you. I'm glad you can tell your side of the story. And look, disconnection is nothing but emotional blackmail. It's the ultimate sadist game of takeaway. We'll take away your family. We'll take away your kids. We'll take away everything if you're not obedient and servile to us. And the Church of Scientology lies about disconnection. They said, well, it's a personal choice our members make. No, it isn't. If a Scientologist refuses to disconnect from someone when ordered to do so by the Office of Special Affairs, they're declared a suppressive person. The church can lie about it all they want, but Scientology's doctrine is disconnection because L. Ron Hubbard etched it in stone, and Scientologists have to obey L. Ron Hubbard. Ron, it's so ice cold when your son, and let's just call him COB to make it easier.
Yeah.
COBRTC, David Miscavige, when he says if he dies, let him die, that is ice cold. But you still wanted to be in touch with your daughters who you love and your grandchildren.
I spent some very good time with them when they were growing up. Both my daughters lived in New Hampshire. I used to go there and I'd take the kids out in the woods and teach them little skills of, you know, how to make a fire, even if it's raining, where to get dry wood, and would make a fire and cook some hot dogs on it or throw potatoes in the fire to bake them, and just had a hell of a good time. I love these kids, and we had a real grandfather, granddaughter, grandson relationship. Now, I don't have that. I don't have a family anymore. Excuse me, my granddaughter, Jenna, I'm in common with her and her husband and her two lovely children. These are great-grandchildren of mine. I'll tell you a little inside thing. We visited with them, and it was the first time I saw them, and just had a hell of a time with them. So I'm talking to Winnie, which is the younger girl. There's Archie and Winnie. Archie is about seven. He's not about. He is 7 years old. And Winnie is 5 years old. And they're both just lovable, very outgoing kids. Little Winnie, I said, look, you already have two grandfathers. I'm your great-grandfather. So just to make sure you're calling me by some name that it would be appropriate, why don't you call me Jadek, which is Polish for grandfather, and it would be unique.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, so Jadek, so I said, what's my name? She said, Bubbles. I said, no, Winnie, listen, sweetheart. My name is Jadek. What's my name? She said, Bubbles. So that's it.
So you're
my
Bubbles.
Name to her is Bubbles. Now, that's the delight I get out of life with, you know, the people, my offspring. I no longer have that. These are pure bastards. I mean, they're lowlifes. They just, and then to be called a church? Are you kidding me? Are you joking? Look, you can get excommunicated from the Catholic Church. That means you can't receive the sacraments. You could still go to Mass. Your friends don't disconnect from you. They still talk to you.
Yeah, they do. What I wanted to add is a couple things. Your granddaughter, Jenna Miscavige Hill, she grew up in Scientology. Because you got your kids into Scientology, she grew up as a third-generation Scientologist.
Now, let me check one thing.
Yeah.
I said Jenna, but also Ronnie, my son, he talks to me. We're in very good communication.
Ron Jr., who used to be a church executive. I'll post a picture when we do the interview, what's called the famous family portrait. It shows David Miscavige with all the executives who are now gone except for maybe two of them.
Yeah.
You know, in 2013, Jenna Miscavige, she wrote a book as well, Beyond Belief, My Secret Life Inside Scientology and My Harrowing Escape. Jenna has to escape just like you, her grandfather. In fact, Jenna grew up with my wife, Karen De La Carrier, her son, Alexander Gench. And they went out to the Oaks School together where they, you know, engaged in manual labor. And, of course, Alexander Gench died in 2012, and he was the son of Heber Gench, who's still the president of the Church of Scientology International. He had to disconnect from his mother in 2010 when Karen left and spoke out publicly. He died because his Scientology in-laws wouldn't give him medical care. They let him lay in bed and die. I got to tell you, that is very brutal.
Jeffrey,
coroner.
Hey,
no, listen to this, Ron. I want to talk about death for a minute. Ed Winter, the coroner, said that if Alexander had been 17 and not 27, it would have been negligent homicide. It's not illegal to let an adult lay in bed and die. And your son says if he dies, let him die. Something that strikes me, Ron, the public should know about. L. Ron Hubbard, was he 74? 1986, you know, late December 85. He has a stroke and he's slurring his words. He can't speak. We don't know if he can read. He has pancreatitis. Aaron Hubbard has a stroke, and does the Church of Scientology? You know, he's up there at his ranch in Creston, California. Do they take him to UCLA Medical Center or somewhere? Do they get him the best medical care money can buy because he's worth something like $400 million? No.
Yeah.
No, they give him a psychiatric tranquilizer, Visceral, to chill him out and let him die in his Bluebird motorhome in this medicated condition with a psychiatric drug. It's almost like the same thing. Well, if L. Ron Hubbard dies, let him die. So this culture of when someone is old and sick and dying, hey, let him die. And on top of that, have his family disconnect from him or her.
Well, see, by that, if I were to die at that point, that would be a problem handled. He wouldn't have to pay $10,000 a week to these PIs. There would be no chance of me going to a newspaper or writing a book. And his public relations image would stay the same. And I feel that at that moment, he saw an opportunity to handle a potential problem in the future, and he would do the, quote, high ground thing of saying, well, look, if it's his time to die, let him die. You know, like pontificating on a person going to croak. But even the PIs, the father said to the son, because his son said this on the interview, he said, look, my dad said to me, hey, I don't care what. If this happens again, you call 911. And, hey, listen, this is subhuman shit, man. You know that.
Oh, yeah.
It's terrible.
Yeah, and let's get into something here, some parallels. Now, it's 1984. Chairman of the board, RTC, David Miscavige, who was then with Author Services International.
Right.
He's being investigated by the IRS Criminal Investigation Division, along with founder L. Ron Hubbard, for income tax fraud.
Right.
And he hires super lawyer Jerry Pfeffer. When he hires Jerry, he gets Monique Yingling, you know, who's married to Jerry.
Yep.
And they work out these IRS CID problems. Now, there's a story, and on my podcast, I try to find out, you know, whether things that are apocryphal are true. You know, I try to figure out, because there's rumors on the Internet. One of the rumors on the Internet is that David Miscavige said in around 84, 85, when all these income tax problems and IRS problems were going on, money laundering.
Yeah.
The best thing that could happen, supposedly David Miscavige said, is if L. Ron Hubbard died. Because, you know, L. Ron Hubbard dies, suddenly there's not a chance of him being arrested or charged or indicted or anything because he's dead. That solved, L. Ron Hubbard's death solved a lot of problems for the Church of Scientology. Because he couldn't be hauled before a grand jury, he couldn't be arrested, he couldn't be criminally charged for income tax evasion, money laundering, and so on. So yeah, when you're running a scammy financial con, when people who know facts, when they die, it's very convenient. And likewise, Annie Tidman, who was married to Pat Broker, you know, when she died, it was very convenient because she had a lot of knowledge of Mr. Hubbard's last days.
Yeah.
She, she died not 10 minutes from where Karen and I live, you know, in a really miserable circumstances of lung cancer. And they, the Church of Scientology didn't even tell anyone she died. I'm actually the one who found out that she died.
Listen, at the in base,
yeah,
we never found out that she died. And I'll give you a little backstory on this, Jeffrey, if we can diverge for a moment.
Please.
I got a Kindle from David for, I think it was a Christmas present. Now, for some reason, unbeknownst to me, the security guards were like cats on a hot tin roof about me having this, and I couldn't figure out why, because they wanted me to give it to them. And I said, what the hell am I going to give this to you? There's books in here. I want this. Okay, that's fine. And the reason they didn't press the point is because David gave it to me as a gift. All right?
Right.
So now I'm reading these books, and there's a, if you have a word that you don't understand, you can underline that and go to the dictionary. And there's like a five-way, well, it's a four-way switch where you can press it up, down, left, or right. And you go to the word that you're trying to get the definition of, and you press it to the right, and it says search dictionary. I pressed it one more time accidentally, and it said search Google.
Mm.
And I pressed it in, and I had, wait, I'm on the outside world right now. I'm on Google. Now the penny dropped as to why they didn't want me to have this. Because if you had a computer on that base, you had to turn it into security, and they put a filter on it so you couldn't see anything that said Scientology or the name Miscavige or anything like that. You could do your shopping, which is how people used to get their things. Instead of driving about 2 miles down the road to a Walmart, they had to buy things on the internet. But anyway, now I'm on Google. So I start searching around for stories about L. Ron Hubbard, about Scientology, and that's where I found out that Annie Tidman had died, and nobody on the base knew this. And subsequent to this happening, I lived in Berthing on the base, and I was going across to the laundry building, which I lived right outside my front door. You'd go into the laundry building and get your sheets and pillowcases, and you could have pants pressed and stuff. And I went in there to get some sheets, and there was a girl outside. Her name's Deirdre. And she said, Ronnie, do you want to chip in some money for Annie Tidman's birthday? Hmm. I said, no, thanks. I'll pass on this. Could you imagine this? Now, she either knew that Annie was dead, but to keep up the ruse, she was collecting money for her birthday to make it look like she was still alive and they were taking care of her in L.A. I'm telling you, man, it's just a different world. It is the bubble. It is the other side of the looking glass.
And that's why the title of your book, Ruthless, is so good. And in fact, you appear in Leah Remini's outstanding A&E show, Scientology and the Aftermath. And there is an aftermath when you leave the church. And really, you're suffering the aftermath of leaving Scientology.
Tell me about it.
Yeah, the aftermath is disconnection. But not only that, you have a multi-billion dollar intelligence agency called the Office of Special Affairs spying on you, spending all that money. I've complained to the IRS, as have many other people, about what happened to you. I'm saying this is not a use of tax-exempt dollars. This is not money spent in the public interest. But beyond that, it's appalling. It's depraved.
Yeah, it is.
Now, you
know, I'm still being followed.
You're still being followed now?
I'm still being followed. We went out to eat at an Indian restaurant last Wednesday, and my wife, who's very sharp at spotting these PIs, said, Ron, we just had a Jeep. I made a U-turn, and this Jeep followed me. And I said, no kidding. She's, yep, we're being followed. So we went in the Indian restaurant, and you could go out the side door and look in the back. There was the Jeep being parked in back there. Now, I have a friend who's who happens to be a PI. He's also an entrepreneur, and he's opening up a restaurant, and I'm helping these guys out with music and various things. And he tried to get the plate number to run it to see what the hell it was, and he got a plate number of a Jeep, but it wasn't the right one, because for whatever reason, we thought that was the one that was following us. But it's funny, when you're looking for Jeeps, You don't see any, and all of a sudden you'll see 30 of them, right?
Yeah.
At any rate, okay, that was a Jeep. Now, the other day, my wife's out shoveling snow. I also shovel snow, but she happens to be out there one day. And there's a lady who walks her dog. Her name is Heidi, and she's read my book, and she follows. She's watching Leah's show, the docu-series she's doing, and she's very interested in us. And she says to Becky, what's the story about that Jeep that's been hanging out in the neighborhood? Unsolicited from Becky.
Hmm.
Yeah, I'm still being followed.
Wow, that is something else. And you know what? Since Leah Remini has made her show, yesterday, Amy Scobie, former WDC Celebrity Centers, Amy posts on Facebook that she's being followed as well because she appeared and told just a heartbreaking story about she and her mother, Bonnie, you know, reuniting, you know, I mean, a month before Bonnie dies. It was just heartbreaking, but it was the humanity of them being able to reconnect was amazing. But they are following Amy Scobie.
And I know, I saw the show, and I'll tell you, heartbreaking is an understatement. It is horrifying that they would do that, but they do it all the time.
You know, when Alexander Jentsch died, they didn't tell Karen. A young man we didn't know at the time Facebooked Karen to tell her that her son Alexander had died. The church didn't plan on telling Karen that Alexander had died. We found out through the kindness of a stranger on Facebook. What happens, Ron, is Karen begins speaking out.
Yeah.
And by the way, that young man who told us was Aaron Smith Levin, and we are so grateful that he let us know that Alexander died. It meant the world. But disconnection, it gets worse than this, because after Alexander died, the church put up hate websites on Karen where she began speaking out. So not only do they kill her son through the policy of disconnection, but now on the internet they call her a prostitute.
Yeah, well, look, this is called character assassination. They do this to everybody who leaves. And is it, they have policies, and I'm sure you've seen them, where the one says, if possible, utterly ruin the person, or another one says, find or manufacture data about the person of lurid or sex things. And then the fair game policy, which everybody knows, where a person can be lied, tricked, or destroyed, and no repercussions against a Scientologist who does this. It's their policy. It's not like something unusual.
No,
and
yes, fair game is L. Ron Hubbard's policy, executed by David Miscavige, Office of Special Affairs. Character assassination, destroy their ability to make income, shutter them into silence. If possible, destroy them utterly. You know, one time, Ron, I had a Jim Lynch, a reporter for Freedom Magazine who died several years ago. He came here to the house. He wanted to interview me. And this is just a pretext to bother Karen and I. And I gave him a piece of my mind. I followed him out to his car. He was with a private investigator who had driven him. And this private investigator was carrying a gun. And I leaned in the car and I said, why do you come to my house with a gun? I don't ever go to your house with a gun, nor would I. How would you feel if I went to your house with a gun? You've got a family. I said, look, you're taking cult blood money. I think it's reprehensible. You're on the wrong side. And to make matters worse, the rental car was brand new, had no paper plates, and he knew I was trying to get a picture of my cell phone of the VIN number and him, and they took off. But these PIs, these thugs who are taking cult blood money, I talked to one of them at an anonymous protest who said, hey, we're just contractors. And this was Talon Executive Services, led by Ron Williams, a former Secret Service agent. So they spend unlimited sums of money to stalk, spy on, harass. And a point Karen has made, Ron, is that Scientology is creating its own enemies. They complain about bitter, defrocked, apostate, suppressive persons, psychiatrists, but they never stop and say, we, the Church of Scientology, by our own policies, are responsible for creating negative press. We're responsible for creating our own enemies. If they had simply treated Leah Remini, you know, when Leah asked, where's Shelley Miscavige?
Well, you know what they could have said?
What?
They could have said, listen, she's on a correction program right now. That's what she's doing. That's why you don't see her. And that would have been the end of it.
Yeah, instead, Tommy Davis says, you don't have a fucking rank to ask that question. And you know, with
arrogant, man. These guys are arrogant.
Okay, so because of the way they treat you, what do they get? They get you produce a number one New York Times best-selling book, which I got to say, Ron, the book is phenomenal. It becomes New York Times bestseller. Leah's producing a television show now, which is watched, the last episode was 2.7 million viewers. Someone like me, because of what they've did to my wife, I have Surviving Scientology, you know, my podcast, and I created the Scientology Money Project. So what Scientology doesn't get is people like us are not going to take it lying down. We're not afraid of them. In fact, we're gonna push back hard. And Ron, what's beautiful about what our site is doing is we're doing it nonviolently and peacefully through free speech. Yep. That's our power, is they can't take away our voice.
Yep, you're exactly right, Jeffrey, because all I would like to see happen is the policy of disconnection banned. Give everybody an amnesty and quit saying that you can produce a superhuman and concentrate on those things where you are able to deliver a product, like improved communication or maybe better interpersonal relationships. Go small, but take your notch in the head for what you've done over all these years, and let all these families rejoin each other. Let all the children in the Sea Org call their mom or their dad and get back in communication with them. And, you know, they'd take a hell of a beating, but at the end, there may be something there. Right now, I don't think they're going to survive this, and I hope they don't, because what they're doing by breaking up families is just not okay with me. And the other thing is this. They say things about me that I'm not even going to repeat here, because they're horrible. But I'm going to tell you something, Jeffrey. I don't care what they say about me. I don't care at all. And I'm still going to keep on doing what I'm doing. I'll do whatever I can to help knock this stuff out so people can be joined. Friends can be friends again. People maybe who lost the job with a Scientology employer can go back to work. Families can be rejoined with each other. That's what I'd like to see. That's the only reason I wrote the goddamn book.
Yeah, to call for some reform. I personally don't think the Church of Scientology in its present form is capable of reforming itself.
Well, wait a minute. Before you go any further, I don't either. But at least I have to say what I feel they should do.
And I understand.
Yeah.
Ron, you were a Sea Org member. Let's change gears here, just so the public who are not familiar with who you are. You were a Sea Org member. What year did you join Sea Org?
I joined the Sea Org on June 30th, 1985.
And for people who don't know your whole story, you're a very talented musician. So when you joined the Sea Org, you became part of the Golden Era band?
Yes, that's right. I went right into the music department and went in as an arranger and a performer, and of course playing on recordings where they needed brass work, because I play cornet, trumpet, and flugelhorn.
And you play with the likes of Peter Schlesch.
Yeah.
Now, so tell people who Peter Schlesch is.
Okay, Peter Schlesch is an accomplished keyboard player, and he wrote a song called On the Wings of Love with Jeffrey Osborne. Peter wrote the melody, and Jeffrey Osborne wrote the words. But when he was 16 years old, he played with the Allman Brothers, and very talented player. But I got to say this, because the church is saying that I'm a failed musician, that I'm no better than a third trumpet player.
Yeah.
And this is not to knock Peter Schlesch, because the guy is a very talented guy and a wonderful person. He came out with a video and said I was a personal embarrassment to him. But what you don't see is the machine guns pointed at them where they're making the video. But sure. I was the only person in the music department who had gotten his own recording deal. This is back in 1974 when I was a public Scientologist in England. Polydor Records signed me up, and I produced an album for them called Freewheeling Ron Savage. I went under the name Ron Savage. And they signed me to a recording as a recording artist. 1 week later, Chapels Publishing signed me on as a writer and gave me royalties on my writings on the album. And in 1975, I think it was February, the album came out. But also, what Polydor did is they came out with another album called The Best of Polydor, and they put one of the songs on my album on that The Best of Polydor recording. Now, That is not what I'd call a failed musician. I'm not tooting my horn, but I'm just telling you, I had some statistics, and right now, as part of their character assassination, they say I'm no better than a third trumpet player, a failed musician, you know, not worth anything, lazy. It is.
Yeah, and Ron, part of fair game is they're going to look for, you know, your buttons. They're going to push that button, and they're going to look to try to get inside your head. And
yeah.
When you realize what they're doing, you can ignore it.
Well, I do, but actually, during this interview, I just thought I'd bring that up. But
oh, I'm glad you did.
I don't think about that at all. I'm glad what they say. Listen, here's how I feel about them. I feel the same about the Church of Scientology as I would if I were walking down the street and a person was walking with a bulldog and the bulldog barked at me. I wouldn't stop and say, well, wait a minute, why are you barking at me? I feel they have about the same rank as that bulldog who's barking at me, because I'll tell you this, a good 99% of everything they say about people who leave are lies.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So, you could go down the list. In fact, Ron, what's really interesting, as a researcher of Scientology, I go onto Scientology website frequently and I read it. Because over the years, I've seen their shifting story. Like, they've had to walk back their claims about L. Ron Hubbard being a World War II hero, nuclear physicist, blah, blah. You know, what was so interesting when they came out with their hate site on you, it was really amusing to me, and I'll tell you why. In the Rathbun case, Monique Rathbun sues David Miscavige and others, right?
Yep.
Now, David Miscavige's lawyer in that case is saying, Captain David Miscavige, don't call my client Captain. His CR rank means nothing, even though we know that the highest ranking member of CR runs the whole church. And they also said that David Miscavige, as RTC, has nothing to do with operating the daily affairs of the Church of Scientology International. And they bent over backwards to prove that the Church of Scientology was not the alter ego of David Miscavige, and David Miscavige was not the managing agent of the Church of Scientology International. So he has nothing to do with it. He runs a little department called RTC, which assures the ecclesiastical purity of the Scientology religion, blah, 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 right?
Yeah.
So, in the Rathbun case, Miscavige is a Mr. Nobody who has nothing to do with anything except correcting semicolons, you know, malicious semicolons in Mr. Hubbard's work, right? And but when they made the hate video on you, suddenly David Miscavige is micromanaging, making sure that the Sea Org has the best kitchens, the best laundry facilities, recreational facilities, organic food. It's like he's micromanaging everything and involved in everyday minutia.
It goes further than that.
Yeah.
Not one song that ever goes on a video presentation or anything to do with anything the church does, not any song ever gets done without his complete and utter approval. He would come to the music area where Peter and I were working together and micromanage what we were producing as a song. I mean, some of it was good. He's pretty sharp that way, but he managed everything. Like, the studio was redone. He managed every square inch of what happened in there, down to picking out the color of the rug.
Really?
Absolutely.
So he's looking at carpet swatches for the studio, for the Ideal Org. So would it be fair to describe David Miscavige as a notorious micromanager?
Oh, I would say so. I want to fight for you, because I'll tell you why I would say so, because he is.
Yeah, and yet, until he's in legal jeopardy, then he doesn't know anything about anything, right?
Right, I know.
A couple things that have gone around the internet and have been asked, and I'll ask you because you're in a position to know. One question that gets asked is, David Miscavige a Scientologist, or does he not believe any of it? What's your opinion?
Well, my opinion is this, because, look, I know David from when he was born. How it was sealed that we would get in Scientology was he was born, he had asthmatic attacks, and all throughout his, you know, infancy and his childhood, I would take him to doctors and try everything under the sun to try to handle this. And, you know, it got to a point where I'd take him to a Dr. Ziegler in Burlington, New Jersey, and he'd give him a shot of adrenaline. That would calm down the asthmatic attack. And I knew that this was not okay to keep doing this to a kid. So, I mean, I did my nut trying to figure out something that could help his asthmatic attack even to the point where if he started having an asthmatic attack, I would take him out in the garage and make him lift weights. I mean, I thought if I could take his attention off it, maybe it wouldn't key in on him. And it worked sometimes. But eventually, I found out about Scientology from a guy named Mike Hess. And there was an auditor, and I took David down to see the auditor. He took him in, and he did creative processing on him for 45 minutes, keyed out the asthma. And David walked out of that session. I said, "How's it going?" He said, "Man, it's going great, Dad." And when I saw that happen, that actually was one of the reasons that we got in Scientology. And I know this, when he was trained as an auditor, from what I could see, people enjoyed being audited by him, and he was very good at it. So if you consider that, that would make him a Scientologist. I know this. He could audit people and produce a result.
Now, Ron, what's interesting is you're a public Scientologist, and you had mentioned to me off-air that when you were 17, your parents gave you permission to join the Marine Corps.
Yeah.
So you were...
Say it. My dad did, and I remember going into the office with a Marine recruiter, and he said, "Jesus Christ, Ronnie, are you sure you want to do this? These guys are the first ones in, you know, the Marines." And I thought, you know, you got to be a little bit nuts to join the Marine Corps, so I qualified on that. But as it turned out, my time in the Marine Corps was one of the most fruitful times of my life. I remember the first night in boot camp where the DI came in. Yeah, if you ever saw Full Metal Jacket, that's how it was.
Oh, one of my favorite movies, yeah.
Well, that's how boot camp started off. That was not an exaggeration at all. Everybody got punched in the stomach or their head bumped against the rack in back of them, and all hell broke loose. And at that point, I said to myself, this is the worst mistake I've ever made in my life. 10 weeks later, I remember thinking, I can make myself do anything. And I developed a discipline that made me a Marine. I came in as an undisciplined civilian, walked out of boot camp a disciplined Marine. And I can tell you that saying, once a Marine, always a Marine, is absolutely true. You never forget that experience. And it's a camaraderie that if you see another guy who's a Marine, you'll always say Semper Fi, and they might go, "Hoorah!" You know?
And yeah.
It never changes. You're always friends with another Marine. They could be 17 years old, like, and me, I'm 80, but that doesn't matter. You never stop being a Marine.
I understand that, and thank you for serving your country. And, you know, so you have the pride of being a veteran, and
right.
You understand service. So fast forward, David Miscavige is 16.
Yeah.
He wants to drop out of high school and join the Sea Org. So you understand that same motive. Okay, so Ron, did you give your son, David Miscavige, permission to join the Sea Org at 16?
Yes, I did, Jeffrey. And I'll tell you why I did. Look, I was 17 years old when I made a decision to join the Marine Corps. And I feel that was one of the most sensible decisions I ever made in my life. I mean, I gained tremendously from it. And I was a dyed-in-the-wool Scientologist. And here he is going to school where the kids are taking drugs next to him, and there's no purpose to it. And I felt a little proud that he would want to go in and help mankind with the technology that L. Ron Hubbard had given us. I mean, that's how I felt at the time. So I says, "Okay, look," I says, "I'll help you. I'll do whatever I can to help you." I bought him some clothes that he wanted, and I gave him some money and bought a plane ticket. And we went down to Philadelphia Airport. And this is the day after his 16th birthday. We're standing inside the airport itself watching them load things on the plane. And what he did, he took his bicycle with him in this huge box. And it was on top of this trolley where they had luggage and everything. And it was raining like hell that day. And just a little amusing side note here, the baggage handler pulled down on it, and all the water that was on top came over and, you know, flushed them down. But anyway, he took the box off, and we had a little bit of a laugh of it, and then laugh at it. And Loretta, even at that point, said, "David, I can't believe you're doing this." She never accepted the fact that he was going to do that, join the Sea Org at that age. But there he was, and he got in the plane and took off. 7 or 8 months later, he was working with L. Ron Hubbard as a cameraman out in the West Coast.
Now, you must have taken a great deal of pride that he was working with Mr. Hubbard.
Well, I did. And as a matter of fact, I tell you, not too far into his career there, he got a leave of absence and he wanted to come and visit me. And he put on this new suit. As a matter of fact, I think I bought him that suit. It was a brown corduroy one. And he went on the set to say goodbye to LRH. And LRH says, "Wow, you look great. Where are you going?" He says, "Well, I'm going on leave." And he says, "Well, have a great time." And he says, "Yeah, I'm going to see my dad." And just before he got out of the studio, LRH says, "Hey, Dave, tell your old man I said hello." Now, when David landed in John F. Kennedy Airport in New York, I was there to pick him up. And he said to me, "Listen, before we say anything, I want to tell you, LRH said to say hello to you, so hi." I was so blown out that I got lost, and it took us about an hour and a half to get out of that Long Island area where the airport was. But it was quite a moment for me. I gotta say that, Jeffrey.
Yes, and the rest becomes history as David Miscavige moves into the, taking over the church.
Yeah.
Ron, what are your feelings looking back on that right now?
Well, I'll tell you, Jeffrey. Look, I feel that I had a duty to write this book. I didn't do it just to have something to do because I had nothing else to do for a couple of weeks. And by the way, I'll tell you, writing this book did not take a long time at all because I knew the story. I wasn't making up anything, and I just wanted to get it down. So we wrote it. What took a lot of time was going over the legal points with an attorney for St. Martin's, and then the copywriting. When I say copywriting, I'm talking about commas and periods and the it apostrophe s, you know, it's
sure.
It just a ton of stuff like that. But writing the book was not a problem at all because I knew what the story was, and I went right to back to the beginning where I was born in Pennsylvania and carried the story right on through to the point where David was born and right up through present time, well, up to all the subsequent events that took place after the PIs were told, you know, if it's his time to die, let him die. And I'm glad I wrote the book because it's something I feel may do some good. Hopefully, people will read it and gut up their courage and say, you know what, I'm going to do something about this. And whatever they can do, I'm not necessarily saying they should write a book, but maybe just walk away from the church the way it is now or help somebody get out, or if somebody comes out, give them a hand when they get out. But I'm going to tell you something, Jeffrey, in the final analysis, I wish it had turned out differently. I wish it didn't turn out this way,
yeah.
But it did, and here I am in present time, and I'm living life right now and enjoying it quite a bit. I hope someday my daughters and my grandchildren and my great-grandchildren will talk to me, and there are times when I think they've gone over to the dark end and I won't ever have any relationship with them again, which is a goddamn shame, and I could prattle on, but I mean, that's how I feel about it. As I said, I wish it hadn't turned out this way. And
yeah, Ron, nobody does it. I mean, the regret, the pain that people live through, and I salute you for having the courage to write your book. And I understand the pain of disconnection, what you're going through. Ron, what I'd like to do is have you on again another show where you talk about what you did while you were in the Sea Org. You know, maybe add another layer to your experience because this is so very fascinating. We've only hit the highlights today. And I want people, our listeners, to know, and you can affirm that there's life after Scientology.
Well, I'll tell you, Jeff, I'm actually enjoying my life right now. Other than not having the companionship of my children who I raised and I love and I wish they were in communication with me. I wish that in the worst way, you know, especially that the holiday is coming because those are some of the most, you know, joyful moments of my life when my kids were little and we would enjoy Christmas together. And one of them in particular was we had a great Christmas as far as her gifts were concerned and company and stuff. And I bought a dog, a little puppy, and I brought it home. And boy, I'll tell you, that made Christmas that year. That dog was the joy. The kids just ignored their Christmas presents, and they just enjoyed the dog. But it's those moments that I miss, that I wish I could have their friendship and communication again. Anyway, I'm doing well now. I'm playing a lot of gigs. Unbelievably, I worked out with this apparatus called an Exergenia, and I'm training a couple of people on how to use it, and that's something I get a lot of enjoyment out of. And there's a restaurant being open, and I'm friends with the two entrepreneurs who are doing it, and I'm helping with their administration of getting that place open. So I'm quite busy, and that's what I'm doing in life right now. Anyway, I'd be happy to come on again with you, Jeff.
Sure. Ron, thank you so much for being on the Surviving Scientology Radio and sharing with our audience, you know, your heart. I really appreciate it and admire what you've done to speak out. For Surviving Scientology Radio, this is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. We've been on with Ron Miscavige, author of Ruthless. Again, I encourage you to read the book if you hadn't. It's a tremendous work. And Ron, thank you. And for Surviving Scientology Radio, this is your host, Jeffrey Augustine. And as always, we'll be in very good touch.